Good news for good renters. No-fault evictions will be banned. New laws could also make it easier for landlords to get rid of bad tenants. It's hoped the plans will improve the sector for everyone.
In a low-income family, we're not getting anywhere. And the stress is getting quite high. We both have anxiety and depression.
We'll get reaction, including why critics claim it could make the housing crisis worse. Also ahead, electric car batteries and Brexit. Vauxhall's parent company warns MPs thousands of jobs are at risk without a new EU deal. The world warming up sooner than you think. The warning we could break the temperature limit within 5 years. And crazy in Cardiff, welcome to Wales. Beyoncé kicks off the UK leg of her world tour.
This is the ITV Lunchtime News with Nina Hussain.
Good afternoon. Big changes are coming for anyone renting a property in England. New rules aimed at improving the state of the rental sector means landlords won't be able to evict people without a good reason. In turn, landlords are being told it will be easier for them to get rid of antisocial tenants. Renters will also get more rights, for example, to have a pet in their home, to rent if they are on benefits or if they have children. But critics say the proposed plans could lead to some landlords selling up and leading to a shortage of flats and houses. Here's Ellie Pitt.
Mandy and Robbie have rented their home for nearly 8 years, but are now packing up the family's life after they were told they were being evicted. They say they don't know where they'll go next because 80 homes they've applied for have all turned them away.
Being a low-income family, we're not getting anywhere, and the stress is getting quite high. We both have anxiety and depression.
But under new potential laws put to Parliament today, protection for renters could include an end to Section 21 or no-fault evictions, which allow landlords to evict tenants without giving a reason. Landlords will be banned from refusing tenancies to people on benefits and with children. And tenants have the right to ask for a pet, which landlords can't unreasonably refuse. Alongside greater security for the millions of private renters in the UK, the Renters Reform Bill will also strengthen the power of landlords to remove antisocial tenants, which could include those causing a nuisance or annoyance.
I don't think it's fair. That's why a lot of the landlords are leaving. It's further legislation, and it will curb the ability for the landlord to recover their property.
Announcing his bill today, Michael Gove met with a private renter and addressed concerns that rent hikes will replace the no-fault evictions if landlords want tenants out.
Well, it is certainly the case that we have to be vigilant about rents everywhere. The good news is that even at a time when people are facing real pressure on their household budgets, that rents in the private rented sector have risen less than inflation. And of course, in this legislation, we affirm that rents can only rise once a year. And if rents are thought to be unfair, there's an ombudsman now that we're creating. And ultimately, there's the backstop of the courts and a tribunal in order to ensure that rents are fixed in a fair market way.
Under the new law, Robbie and Mandy would never have received a Section 21 notice to leave their home. The bill has come too late for them, but could protect others seeking stability in a turbulent housing market. Ellie Pitt, ITV News.
Vauxhall's parent company, Stellantis, has warned the Prime Minister he needs to renegotiate the UK's Brexit deal or it'll have to close its plants here. Stellantis is the world's fourth biggest car maker, but it says it'll soon be unaffordable for it to make electric vehicles in the UK. Why? Well, from next year, unless the batteries for the cars are made here or in the EU, they'll face a 10% tariff. Our political correspondent Carl Dinan has the details and the government's response.
The message from the owners of Vauxhall couldn't be clearer. If Britain is going to build electric vehicles, then Britain needs to build batteries. And until that happens, large-scale production is at risk under the trade deal struck with the EU.
I think everyone is concerned about this. I mean, we're an export-led industry. 80% of what we produce goes abroad, most to Europe, but also globally. To meet any free trade deal, you need to meet those rules of origin. Everyone's concerned. Given the dependence of battery materials from beyond UK, beyond Europe, how are you going to meet them?
The rules of origin in the post-Brexit trade deal with the EU say that from next year, 45% of an electric car's value must come from the UK or the EU. If not, the EU will impose a 10% tariff on UK-built cars, making them uncompetitive. Manufacturers and unions want the government to renegotiate.
They should be sitting around a table with Europe to try to renegotiate the agreement of rules of origins and to make it a lot easier to trade in Europe and so that we can export to the European market.
The business secretary has raised the issue with the EU, which would also face tariffs trading the other way. And this morning, the chancellor seemed to hint at a solution to the lack of battery capacity.
The reality is there is a supply shortage. Everyone is trying to develop supply of EV batteries, and so we need to have that supply here in the UK. The closer it's located to the factories that are making the rest of the car, the better. And all I would say is watch this space, because we are very focused on making sure the UK gets that EV manufacturing capacity.
There was a plan to build a huge British battery plant in Northumberland, but in January, the company behind it, British Volt, collapsed into administration. New owners have been found, but the project is delayed. So the short-term solution to protecting jobs in the British motor industry, and Stellantis alone employs 5,000 people, seems to lie in renegotiating yet another part of the Brexit deal. Carl Dinan, ITV News, Westminster.
For more on this, let's join our business editor, Joel Hills, who is in Luton at one of Vauxhall's plants. Joel, just how much trouble could the electric car revolution in the UK be if changes aren't made?
Well, the revolution is going very slowly and it could be in an awful lot of trouble. You can see the shift changes happening at Luton behind me as we speak. The submission that has been made from Stellantis, a company which owns Vauxhall, yes, but also Citroën, Peugeot, Fiat and a host of other car brands, it is very clear that Brexit is to blame for the fact that both of its factories in the UK are at risk. Brexit's to blame in as much as there are new rules since we left the EU which govern tariff-free access. A car made here in Britain, if it is to be sold in mainland Europe, has to meet certain criteria, meet certain thresholds for content, as Carl was explaining just. And Stellantis clearly doesn't think that now it is going to be able to do that. But, and there is a big but, this is also a problem for European manufacturers. I happen to know that there are car makers in Spain, car makers in Germany, who are telling their governments that they are not going to be able to make those thresholds too. And so cars coming the other way here to the UK will attract exactly the same tariffs. I have to say, that being the case, it would seem to be, if you apply common sense, in everyone's interest for both sides to sit round a table and thrash out a solution of the sort that Stellantis is proposing, i.e. that the rules of origin changes are delayed until 2027. But the bigger point that the submission makes, and one which rings very true, is around battery capacity. There are 40 gigawatt factories that are in the process of being built or have started operating in Europe. Only two are being built in the UK. We were told, weren't we, before the referendum, that Brexit would be a disaster for the industry. Since 2016, we have seen production fall. We've seen decisions like the collapse of British Volt, like Mini deciding to build new electric vehicles in China. These do rather suggest that Britain has become a much less attractive place to build cars.
Joel Hills, thank you very much. Thank you. A man's been charged with murdering two people who were found dead at a house in Huddersfield. Marcus Osborne, who is 34, is due to appear at Leeds Magistrate Courts later. Police were called to a house in Dalton on Monday morning, where the bodies of Katie Higton and Steve Harnett were found. It's now emerged both victims had contacted the police just days before their deaths. The police watchdog is investigating that situation. Next, what impact is the high cost of living having on you? New research from the Financial Conduct Authority shows it's hitting people hard financially and harming their mental health. The figures show 11 million people are now struggling with bills and food costs. That's up by over 3 million since last year. More than 1 in 10 people have missed at least 3 bills or loan payments in the last 6 months. And almost 1 in 3 people with a mortgage have seen their payments increase in the last 6 months. I'm joined now by our reporter, Andrew Misra. Yet more evidence of what impact what we're all experiencing is having on people.
Well, exactly. As you say, the price of pretty much everything has gone up over the past 18 months, hasn't it? From energy to food to fuel. Inflation's still above 10%, meaning that most things are 10% more expensive than they were a year ago, which is putting real pressure on people's budgets. We're hearing, for example, of people having to cancel or reduce their insurance policies to deal with this. And in this FCA survey that's come out today, it shows that half of all people in the UK are now more anxious or stressed about the cost of living than they were previously. And we can get a sense of that now, of that worry, from a 74-year-old pensioner in South London who is really struggling with her bills at the moment.
Your mind actually thinks that, well, I haven't managed well, I'm such a failure, I should have thought and this and done this better, and it actually pulls you down, makes you feel like you are a fool.
And she's not alone. So what has the watchdog done in terms of suggesting how they can help?
Well, it's telling firms to support customers, reminding 3,500 lenders, it says, of their responsibility to support those borrowers who are in financial difficulty. But the Money and Mental Health Policy Institute says that the FCA needs to do more to crack down on what it calls aggressive debt collection practices. The FCA, though, is keen to point out that it's provided £29 million in compensation from those lenders for 80,000 customers. The advice to people, if they are struggling, is to contact those lenders as soon as possible. But with those household bills expected to keep rising into the autumn, it's likely that these calls for more support will only continue to grow.
Andrew Misra, thank you very much. Thank you. Still to come, why your bus fare home isn't going up anytime soon. Plus, Beyoncé's back in the UK, the fans flocking to her money-spinning tour in Cardiff. Before that, the world is warming up much faster than scientists first thought. Researchers now believe our overheating planet could break the key temperature limit of 1.5 Celsius within 5 years. If their predictions come true, it will impact our health, what we eat, and the environment we share with wildlife. Warren Nettleford takes us through the numbers.
Scientists are warning that average global temperatures are more than likely to increase over the next 5 years. But what does that mean for the environment and for us? Scientists from the World Meteorological Organization say that temperatures could reach more than 1.5 degrees above pre-industrial levels. They also say there's a 98% chance that the hottest year on record will be broken during this time. Scientists say it will likely come from a combination of greenhouse gases and a naturally occurring El Niño event, a heating of the eastern Pacific which affects rainfall and temperatures globally. Researchers warn that the effects of rising average temperatures will have far-reaching consequences for health, food security, water management and the environment. Temperatures in the Arctic are predicted to increase 3 times faster than the global average. That will lead to glaciers melting faster, while increased greenhouse gases will also lead to more extreme weather and oceans becoming more acidic. The question now being asked is, are we ready? If a 1.5 degree temperature rise is recorded, it wouldn't break the limit set in the Paris Climate Agreement. That's because a 1.5 degree rise would need to be recorded many more times before being seen as permanent. But this latest prediction by climate scientists is being seen as a warning that our climate is rapidly changing.
Warren Nettleford there. And there was yet further evidence of the extreme weather we're already experiencing. In northeast Italy, at least 5 people have died and thousands have been evacuated after rivers swollen by days of flooding burst their banks. Formula One has just announced this weekend's Grand Prix has been cancelled in Imola because of the flooding. Days of heavy rains have hit Italy and the Balkans, where where floods, landslides and evacuations were reported in Croatia, Bosnia and Slovenia. Here, a tram driver has gone on trial at the Old Bailey over a derailment that killed seven people in Croydon. Opening the case, the prosecution told the court there is no dispute that the driver, Alfred Dorris, was responsible. The jury heard that passengers were flung around as if in a washing machine as the driver attempted a curve at more than three times the speed limit. Ian Woods was in court. Some distressing evidence heard in court this morning, Ian.
Yes, the prosecution opened the case by describing the morning of November 2016 when the crash happened as an ugly one. Wintry, dark and rainy. Tram 2551 had 69 passengers on board when it derailed in Croydon in South London. Alfred Dorris, who you can see here in the middle as he arrived at court, was the driver and bore responsibility for the crash. But he's pleaded not guilty to a breach of health and safety at work legislation. Transport for London, which owns the infrastructure, and Tram Operations Limited, which manages the service, have both accepted failings and they'll be sentenced at a later date. Now, when the tram approaches the Sandyland stop, there's a sharp left bend and the tram is supposed to slow to 20 kilometres an hour. But on this morning, it took the turn at more than 70 kilometres an hour and derailed. Passengers were thrown around inside the carriages and out through smashed windows. Seven died, 19 were seriously injured. The court heard that in interviews after the crash, Mr. Dorris said he was disorientated and confused, thinking he was heading in the opposite direction. But he denies being drowsy or falling asleep, and he blamed environmental and external factors outside his control. His record was impeccable, and he was regarded by the company as one of their better drivers. But the court was told that no risk assessment had been carried out which looked into the possibility of a derailment. Barrister Jonathan Ashley Norman QC, KC said that a blind spot was allowed to develop and a risk which should have been obvious was overlooked. But Mr. Dorris is on trial because he allegedly failed to take reasonable care for the health and safety of his passengers.
Ian Woods, thank you. Next this lunchtime, why bus passengers across England will enjoy cheaper journeys at least until the end of October. The £2 cap on fares has been extended until then. Kelly Foran has this for us from Preston.
We're at Preston bus station where each and every day here, hundreds of bus services leave from here. Thousands of passengers travel through here, but not as many as there used to be. The number of people using buses up and down the country is yet to reach the levels that they were at before the pandemic. Now, one way to try and boost those numbers, the amount of people using buses, was the government introducing a £2 cap on fares. That hasn't, though, translated into the number of people using some of the services.
So passengers have been really engaged with the £2 bus fare. It's given them an opportunity to look at bus again and think, oh, actually, maybe I could use that for some of my journeys. And it's got some positivity going around bus travel, which is a really good thing. It hasn't yet translated into a sizable increase in passenger numbers. I believe that's because in many parts of the country, bus fares were already at £2 or thereabouts. And it's a relatively small number of longer journeys where it's having a huge impact.
That £2 cap on fares was due to expire, but it's been announced today that it will continue for now anyway. It will continue until October, and then from November, the government will subsidise bus fares up to £2.50. That's going to cost them £200 million for the next year. On top of that, the government say they are pledging £300 million so that local councils like here can keep some of the bus services that people rely on for education, to get to work or to go to appointments. Now, many of the people that we've spoken to here today have free bus passes. They're pensioners or students. For students in particular, if that price cap doesn't continue, things could look very different for them in the future.
Kelly Foran reporting from Preston. Finally, this lunchtime, the huge star getting a warm welcome in Wales. Beyoncé is kicking off the UK leg of her world tour in Cardiff. But it's not only the singer who'll make millions from her appearance in the Welsh capital, as Faye Barker now reports.
Beyoncé's back on stage, and tonight her Renaissance tour lands in Cardiff. After opening shows in Stockholm and Brussels, it's now the turn of fans in the UK to see their bay. In Cardiff, queues started building up outside the Principality Stadium this morning as fans look forward to this. Some have travelled from all corners of the world.
I got up nice and early to get on an early train.
While others, like Lewis Royal, are making their way to the Welsh capital from other parts of the UK.
I've always said that I need to see Beyoncé before I die. Like, that's just something I have to do. I can't wait to just experience everything. It's just going to be like a religious experience.
Tonight in Cardiff is the first of Beyoncé's UK shows. The star released this silent teaser footage of what fans can expect as it moves on to Edinburgh, Sunderland and London over the next 2.5 weeks. Beyoncé will perform over 50 times across Europe and the United States in the coming months, expecting to earn her an estimated $2 billion. It's lucrative too for the local area, with Cardiff Council predicting millions will be channeled back into the Welsh economy from tonight's event. Hits from earlier in her career are on the set list alongside her latest tracks from what was her first studio album in 6 years. And it's 5 years since she last toured the world. For the 60,000 fans descending on Cardiff tonight, there's no better place to be. Faye Barker, ITV News.
That's all we've got time for so far today. Mary's here with the very latest on the ITV Evening News at 6:30. From everyone on today's lunchtime team, whatever you're doing, enjoy the rest of your afternoon. Bye-bye.